shower yesterday, which wasn't quite on time for Sunday, but I'll just share the rest of it tonight. So I've been praying, and I'm like, Lord, how did Joshua and Esther go together? I know that they're the beginning and the end of the historical books of the Bible, right? And it came to me that Joshua was the establishment of a nation, right? He was the establishment of the promise. And sometimes those promises need to be established in our lives, right? Sometimes we're believing for things, and we need to just stand our ground and take the land, right? And then in Esther, it was the protection, right, or the restoration of the promise. And there's promises that we hold sometimes that we go through life and we go through things and we forget about those promises. And there's times when God wants to bring them back to life and protect them and restore them. And I feel like that's what God's doing for us, right? He's always establishing new things and he's restoring the old in us. And he makes all things new. And so so whatever you're believing for, whatever it is that's going on in your life, just know that either God's going to establish it or he's going to restore it. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. We'll just tack that on the end of everything I talked about on Sunday. Anybody have any prayer requests or praise reports tonight they'd like to share? Yeah. Lord. Anybody else? Prayer requests? Or, yeah, Tim.
Yes, I want to thank the Lord how he worked with us. You know, one day as I was going to work, it was like sometimes we think about our past, you know, and we'll share it with somebody. And the Lord just let me know that sometimes we just need to let that go, even though it's hurt, and we say we've forgiven those individuals. But when we keep bringing it up, it's like you're opening up again. That's where we need to leave it. I know we're human beings, but we can do that. But he's a present God, present help, and he wants us to go forward in our lives. And that's what thing I'm learning, you know, to move forward. You know, even if we make a mistake, not to dwell on it,
right.
You know, but to move forward. Like today, I'm working in the classroom, and we have a whiteboard, you know, and I still don't know where it came from, but somebody, I don't know what, I've got a permanent marker in the middle of that, and that is not good, you know, because part of it, I had the other one in, and I was erasing it, and the other part didn't come off, you know, and I used to be so frustrated with stuff like that happening, you know, and then, so I had a break, so I Googled it, how to get it off, you know, and one of the students came up, and what she said, I already seen on the computer how to do it, and she came up and showed me, and it, you know, it's faint still on the board, but it come off, you know, and I would just thank God for the blessing of that,
mm-hmm.
you know, that it was confirmed real quick. I mean, it was just a matter of minutes how God works, and it's like, Tim, you know what? When something is done, you can't go back and undo it. You know, and it's the same way in our lives, you know. Some people say, well, I wish I could go back and do this over again. The one thing about it is that we can't live our lives in reverse.
Right.
You know, we got to go forward. Like there was an Eastern proverb said, we live our lives forward, but we understand backwards.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when we look back on our life, and God says, you know what? That's old. All things are past. All those old things, all those things are passed away. And all things become new, so he wants us to move forward. And that just really, really something that God just brought to my attention.
Great.
This
Thank
is
you.
What I
praise
thank
the Lord.
For that.
Amen.
Yes, praise the Lord. Anyone else this evening? No? All right, well, let's stand and invite the Lord in tonight. And we want to have the ladies come pray for. Father,
thank you, Jesus. Father, we just bless you. We praise you. Thank you for the finished work of the cross. Lord, we just thank you right now for touching Carol. Thank you for healing her, for restoring right now in Jesus' name. Thank you for the mercy. Father, we just bless you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you for your faithfulness, Jesus. Thank you for your goodness.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Praise God.
Thank you,
Lord Jesus. Thank you. By your strength, Jesus. Declare in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord, you're worthy.
In every situation, in every circumstance, for everybody. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we love you. We love you so much.
But
it doesn't compare to the great love that you have for us, Lord. We'll never, our minds cannot comprehend, our hearts can never understand the depth and the power of your love. It was your love that sent Jesus to the cross. It was your love that brought him back to life and the power of resurrection. And it's your love, your Holy Spirit of love that lives within our hearts, Lord, that renews our minds. And we thank you, Lord, that when we pour it out, Lord, you continue to pour it in. And as we pour it out, Lord, you pour it in. Thank you that your life, Jesus, was a reflection of love. That your life, Jesus, was a reflection of purity of heart, Lord, and of your kingdom, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We come tonight, we gather together in your midst, in your house, this house of prayer.
Yes.
We gather together to lift you up, to lift up the name of Jesus, the name above all names, that all tongues should confess, that every knee should bow. But we come tonight, Lord, willingly, joyfully into your house, Lord, to praise you, to worship you, to gather together, to link arms, to lift one another up in our daily lives and in the burdens that come with this living in this fallen world. We ask for your blessings to flow as we worship, as we praise, as we renew our minds by the hearing of your word tonight. Let your presence, let your Holy Spirit have its way, Lord, to renew our minds, to encourage our spirits, Lord. Help us to focus on the mark ahead as we press forward, Lord, not to look behind, not to look to the left or to the right, but to press forward to the high calling you have for each of us, Lord, as you continue to stir up the gifts, Lord, that we might minister together the full picture of Jesus Christ in this world. And we call out to those who are not here, Lord. We call out to those members of this body who are not here and those who have yet to find their home here. We call to the north and the south and the east and the west, Lord, that you draw them, that you tug on the hearts of men and women all through this city, Lord, all through this region. And I thank you, Lord, as you're knitting together a tapestry of your grace, a tapestry of your love, Lord, that reveals who you are and your great love for us, Lord. Be glorified, be lifted high, Lord, as your kingdom comes and is revealed through each of us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Just a reminder that if you brought your cell phone with you tonight, to please silence them or turn them off. And let's speak the word together tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
All right. And Ron, do you want to come take the offering tonight?
Thank you.
Thank you.
time in the last 2 months. As soon as I walked up on the west side of there by the front pew, just on this side of it, there's a fragrance. It smelled like violets. I'm not sure what the fragrance was. I don't know what it was. All I know is a sweet, sweet smell. That's the third time in the last couple months. And then Sheila responded to that post I made on it. Apparently when she brought Jayla at last Easter gate, it was over by where Pastor was standing, they could smell that same fragrance. And I'm not all about, you know, manifestations being primary, it's secondary, it's just a confirmation of things that we already know. But he loves us.
One night,
yes.
Venus.
God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Mike, Suzanne, James. Thank you very much. Buddy. Praise the Lord. Appreciate y'all being here tonight. Thanks to Tim and Suzanne for covering for me last week. Praise the Lord. And for what we could see from Sunday, you guys had a great time. Praise the Lord. That's a good thing. Amen. And happy for that. Praise the Lord. And I appreciate you guys being there when I need a little extra time. Praise the Lord. And so it's good to be in the house of the Lord again and to be with all of you. And I want to talk to you this evening. Just have a kind of a Bible study here, but I'm in preparation for what I want to do Sunday, and it's kind of hard to disconnect. So you're going to be a little bit ahead of everybody else on Sunday. Say praise the Lord for that. Smarter than everybody else. Well, maybe not smarter. You'll just have more information. But I'm not trying to rewrite the book here, but I think sometimes we need to go back and reestablish the old landmark, so to speak. And I think sometimes it's easy living. I love what Tim said, that, you know, we live our life forward, but we see it in reverse. I mean, we're always moving forward, but we're always looking at what has already happened for the most part. And I think sometimes it's easy always looking to today and the next day to not realize what we may have missed in the past. Not talking about personal sin or anything, but I'm talking about the true establishment of the church and how the church, biblically speaking, exists. Now, anybody that knows me knows that I am a strong believer in the gifts of the Spirit, in the miraculous, in the supernatural. There's no question about it. It's biblical. It's the Word of God. But sometimes we can get the cart in front of the horse, if you know what I'm saying. And I think, and based on, you know, every church is this way. I don't have anything to do with other churches in terms of, you know, input or, you know, what goes on there. But I do realize that churches in general are not what they were in the first century.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Now, obviously, there's going to be some changes because of inventions and science and so on and so forth. But the fundamental aspect of what the church is and how it should operate ought to still be the guide, ought to still be the template or the established way of doing things. And so most of you have heard me talk about things. You know, we see things that happen in church services, and I can't find any Bible for it. Now, that doesn't mean that God can't do things that are not contrary to his word, but maybe not established in the word. But you'll never make a mistake in terms of being in sync with God by going back to the fundamentals, back to what God has established in his word. And that's what I want to talk to you about a little bit tonight. This is not an indictment. This is not an attack. This is nothing. I don't want you to think it's anything like that, because it's not. Hopefully it doesn't come across that way. But I do think that sometimes we need to just take a step back and relook at everything and see where are we terms of what God's doing and what God has always done. Because even though God's doing a new thing, it's not a new thing to God.
Right.
It's only new to us. Amen. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yes.
And so what he establishes, that's the way that it should work. Now, one of the things I struggle with in prayer and in other areas is that I want to see what I see here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if I don't see that, then there's a reason. There has to be something that can tell me why that's not the case. Now, we know it's God, and we love God, and we know that we have forgiveness and grace and so on and so forth. So it isn't so much about, in this sense, revelation as it is operating in truth, operating in sync with the way the Holy Spirit works, right? The Holy Spirit, he comes to reveal Jesus. I mean, that's what the Holy Spirit is here. He's always pointing to Jesus. He always speaks of Jesus. After all, he's the Spirit of Christ. He is the Christ in you, the hope of glory. So he's always going to direct us to Christ, not to some other thing.
Right.
And the truth is, Sally and I were talking about this today. Somebody, she was watching on Christian TV, and he had said something that I have said different times, which is that people are always talking about this person having an anointing for this or this person having an anointing for that. And I understand that, because if they're operating in a particular gift, it's easy to say, well, he has an anointing or she has an anointing for that particular. That's not the case. There's only one anointing.
Right.
And that's Jesus. He is the anointed one. And when we receive Christ, we receive that anointing, which means that we have access then to every gift, every miraculous intervention that God has ever done or ever wants to do is available to us because of Christ. So if we're not operating in that, then maybe the question is not as much about our quote-unquote anointing as it is about us being in Christ.
Yes.
Now, I'm not talking about salvation here. I'm talking about actually living your life in Christ. Now, I get as frustrated and aggravated as anybody, and maybe more than some, but it's frustration with myself more than it is anything else. I mean, I know what God can do. It's just the frustration is with me connecting with that, right? And so that's my goal here. That's my concern. And so tonight I'm not going to be real in-depth or anything, but it's kind of setting things up for what I really want to talk about Sunday, which is the church. And there's all kinds of, we make all kinds of, you know, kind of self-determined definitions of the church. You know, one person will say, well, I am the church. Well, in a sense, that's true. But the church is a body. It's a collective unit of people.
Yep.
And when you look at the scripture, I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but when you look at scripture, it's not really about you or me. It's about us. It's about the body, amen? And whatever, wherever that body is, however it functions, there are people that say, well, you know, I don't need to go to church because I am the body of Christ. Well, that's not biblical. I can tell you that right now. I'm not picking on people for not being in church. That's between them and God. But I am saying you can't be the body of Christ if you're not gathering with a body. You can't, you're just not going to, it's not going to happen. That's not the way it was ever designed. You go back and look at the original, the church was born in the book of Acts. And if you look at the church that comes out of that, it's always groups. It's always people that come together. Now, it wasn't in a specific church building, but the church was this body of people that got together.
Yeah.
Amen. And glorified the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And so worshiped God and prayed together and all those kinds of things. That's what a church is. That's what a church does. You can't, you're not going to have that by having, you know, just having a Bible reading at home by yourself or, you know, with one other person or what have you. That isn't the way it works. There's nothing wrong with that. We should do that.
Right.
But you can't say, I don't need to go to church because I got this. Because they're two totally different things altogether. Amen?
Right.
So with that said, let's go to Philippians chapter 2 and verse 21. All you have to do is start reading the epistles, which are just letters to churches, and they're addressed to specific people in specific places where there were groups together. And that's how we identify a church. And so anyway, here we go. Philippians chapter 2, verse 21 says, "For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ." Amen? For all seek their own, and not the things which are Jesus Christ. Now, let me see. Let's go to Genesis chapter 3, verses 5 through 7, and just put this in a context. Okay, so everybody seeks their own and not the things which are Jesus Christ. Now, this is Paul writing to a church in Philippi. These are believers. Okay? So now, if we go back to Genesis, you'll see in this place, this is where the serpent has deceived Eve, and actually he plays on her pride, on her selfishness, if you will. "And for God doth know that in the day that ye eat thereof," this is the devil talking to her, "then your eyes will be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons." So what we're talking about here in both of these scriptures is fundamentally it's pride. And pride says that I've got it figured out. I've got this. I understand now. I just needed a little insight, and now I understand. Now I got it. So it's an assertion of independence. And we live in a time when there's more and more of that kind of attitude. You know, I'm my own man, my own woman, I'm independent, I don't have to answer to anybody or anything, amen? And so it's a way of focusing on self and special knowledge, the kind that you think you get from forbidden fruit. Praise the Lord. Well, I'm not being mean here. I'm just saying. Sometimes, you know, I'm going to be like God if I can ever get to the place where I know as much as God. This is the original problem. Right. That ain't going to happen. Right. It's not going to happen. So, and the reason it's not going to happen is because, not because God doesn't trust us, because he has imparted all of this to us, but he wants us to depend on him.
Yes.
We're not free agents in this thing. If we're not operating in Christ, it's all a waste of time anyway.
Right.
It's not going to go anywhere. It's not going to last. It's not going to have any eternal value. All right? So, look at Luke now, chapter 1, verse 51. Now, this is when Mary and Elizabeth have interacted here, and Mary has been told that she's going to have the Christ, you know, the Messiah. And Elizabeth, the baby, jumps in her womb and so forth. And then they have this brief conversation. And then Mary goes into this praise to God because of what God's doing in her. Amen. And here's what she says. "He hath showed strength with his arm. He hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts." Now, what I'm talking about is not us specifically. I'm talking about how it's so easy to pick up the latest CD or DVD or book or whoever the most popular guy is on TV right now preaching this or that or the other thing. And we forget that God has showed the strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. And that's like being locked in the prison of pride.
Right.
It's like being trapped in your own ego, in a sense. Amen? So look, because in verse 51, he says, "has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts." And Mary's words are like what Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verses 21 through 24. Romans 1, 21 through 24. So here it's real similar to what Paul says in Romans 1. "Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like the corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. And we know how that goes on. But really, the focus of this is that they manufacture in their own minds what God is. And actually, what it's actually describing to us is that they make themselves gods. Mm-hmm. They become the end all and the be all of everything that's going on. So, with that in mind, look at Ecclesiastes chapter 1 and verse 14. I have seen all the works that are done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and vexation of spirit. Now what he's saying here is, and if you know that the word works is dominant, and it goes back to what Paul was talking about and back to what Mary was talking about. All the works that are done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and vexation of spirit. Anything that we do outside of Christ is vanity. Doesn't make it all bad. It just means it doesn't have eternal value. Right? If we're not doing it in Christ, we're just going through the motions. And that's my focus here. All of our works. Now you see what I'm saying, that the examination of our heart, do we really trust God? Do we trust Him with everything? Is our confidence in God or in our revelation or in some person or in some thing? Nothing wrong with any of the things. I don't want people to be freaking out. I know I say things sometimes so you think, well, okay, we had this aroma. I know it happens. It happens. It does. Yeah. It's the Lord. Yeah. Just like we hear, we see, you know, we have visions. There's things like this happen all the time. I'm not against any of that. I'm just saying those things are ways of, like was said earlier, those are ways of confirming what we already know to be true in the Lord. They're not what we're looking for. Right. If we're looking for Christ, if we're focused on Jesus, these things are just the add-ons. Exactly. It's like the, you know, you go out and buy the car, and then you find out, whoa, it's got power windows, you know. Man, oh, how about that? It's got positive traction, or it's got four-wheel drive, or it's got these other things that you really weren't expecting. You knew what the car was, but you didn't know you were going to get these extras, right? And they don't take away from the car. They just add to the joy of driving the car, or being, you know, having that experience. Well, that's the way it is with Jesus. He gives us these extras, if you will, to enhance the experience of being in Him, of living with Him and trusting Him. But you don't get them simply because they're out there. You get them by trusting. You get them by believing, by having confidence in the Lord. Amen? So, are we trusting God or putting our confidence in Him? Or do we use God to get something from Him? Or is God Himself the goal? And that's where we can get it's so easy. The lines cross and there's gray areas there. It's easy to kind of get confused sometimes and forget the goal here is Jesus. Amen. To be in Christ. And whatever comes from that, I'm all for it. I'll take any of it, you know. But I don't want to go after the thing and miss the goal.
Yes.
You know, I don't want to go after the peripheral thing and miss the focus of what it is God. And see, this is one of the struggles we have in the charismatic church, even within Pentecost itself. And because it's so easy over time to get caught up in the next experience, you know, or vision or whatever it is, and miss the fact that they're only there to validate the fact that we're operating in Christ, that we're working in sync with Jesus. We're not supposed to be looking for the thing. The goal is supposed to be Jesus, not the extra benefits. Am I making sense? Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
So, look, go back to Philippians chapter 2 and verses 3 and 4. Now, I love the letter to the Philippians because it reminds me of me, as well as some of the others, Corinthians and a couple of others that had to have a little correction there. But Paul is, you know, he's writing to real people.
Yep.
Now, obviously, it's still pertinent today, or they wouldn't still be in there.
Right.
But the original letter, he wasn't writing it in the sense that he knew it was going to be in a codex at some point. He wasn't writing it like he knew necessarily that this is going to be the book of Philippians. He was writing a letter to believers,
right,
trying to help them to stay focused on the goal and not get distracted by other things in the process, right? So let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Praise the Lord. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's interesting to me in this particular passage is the word things there isn't actually in the Greek text. It's a filler word. It's a word that they put in because they didn't know what else to put in there. Because it didn't give them a definitive word, so they just said things. They just use that word. So there's an openness, actually, in this writing. The way Paul originally wrote it, there's an openness implied in that line. That let each of you look not only on his own blank, whatever, fill in the blank, get it? You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Don't look, just look at your own problem with this or benefit of this or that thing. But he says, just fill in that blank with whatever's relevant at the moment, amen? So what's the motivation then? So look not only to his own stuff, whatever it is, whatever the issue is, whatever the problem is, but every man also on whatever that is for others.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
So the motivation, the foundation of life that's not built on self, on ambition, on conceit, but service and sacrifice for others. That motivation that Paul's talking about, that foundation is Jesus himself. Look at it in Philippians 2, and we'll just continue on verses 5 through 11. Let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of men. Being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. So the Bible says it's all about Jesus.
Yes.
Focusing on anything else is going backwards.
Yes.
Yep.
So it isn't the latest ministry thing. Mm-hmm. Those things all take care of themselves.
Yes.
If we keep the focus, Jesus.
Yes.
My feeling is, and I could be wrong, but this is what I see, is that the focus in most churches has become other things. Now, we're not denying Jesus. It's just that Jesus isn't the main thing. It's this particular ministry. This particular ministry. That anointing. This anointing. Some other anointing. Instead of the focus being on Christ. If the Holy Spirit, who is the one who imparts gifts, right? It's the Holy Spirit that we've received.
Right.
He's always pointing us to Jesus. He's not pointing us to the gifts.
Right.
He's always talking about Jesus.
Right.
And if we keep the focus on Jesus, then the gifts will take care of themselves.
Yes.
It's what the scripture says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Who's the righteousness?
Yes.
Jesus Christ is the righteousness of God, amen, and he has imparted his righteousness to us and taken our sin. That was the great exchange. So the focus is to be on Jesus, and all the stuff gets added as a result of that. The problem is we've made all the individual things priorities, and in the process we've minimized the real goal, the real purpose, which is Jesus and being in Christ, living our lives in Jesus, not living our lives as this anointing or that anointing or some other anointing, but living in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So, Bible says Jesus, creator, is also the sustainer of creation.
Yes.
So not only is the word the creator, but the word holds everything together as well. Now look at this in Colossians chapter 1, verse 17. And this is just validating what I've just said, but it's biblical here, so you know, and most of you have already read these, but he is for all things, and by him all things consist. Okay? That pretty much settles that, right? He was before anything, and everything that is now is held together by him.
Yep.
It only makes sense then, he ought to be the priority, right? I mean, that's just logical. All right, Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3 just says it in another way, a little more forceful maybe. Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. That's the position of power and authority, the right hand. Amen?
Amen.
So it's not so much a geography identification as it is a power identification. Because, I mean, after all, God takes up all space, right?
Mm-hmm.
We used to have this argument. So how far did Jesus have to go to get the right hand? So we understand it's talking about he's positioned in the place of all power. We know that he has all power. All power was given to him. Amen? So he's also one with the Father because he tells us, as my Father and I are one, so you shall be one with me, and we will all become one, and so on and so forth. All right? So now, let's go on. That's Hebrews 1 and 3. Now, if you will, try to follow me here because I know I'm not really in sync that much here tonight, but if you can follow where I'm going here, when the Romans, here's a perfect example. When the Romans arrest Jesus, they grab him with hands, amen, right? With their arms and their hands, and they grab him. And these things were not only created by Jesus, but at the same time, he was sustaining the very ones that were taking him prisoner, the ones that beat him, the hands and that whipped him, the hands that grabbed him. He created them. Think about that.
Right.
It's amazing. Not only did he create them, but he was sustaining them at the very moment that they were doing the things to him that they were doing. All right? So look at Matthew chapter 26, verse 52 and 53. In essence, the power that they used to grab him comes from him. Yes, 52 and 53 of chapter 26. Now that's amazing to me, because it's one thing to take a whipping, you know, but it's another thing to empower the person to whip you.
Yeah.
Not to just give in and let them, but actually give them the strength and sustain them through the beating. And that's what Jesus did. This is not like any man we know.
Right.
He was God in the flesh. And I think we just need to be reminded sometimes, we let so much of this stuff go without actually looking at what in the world actually happened here. This is amazing. It's too much to describe. Then said Jesus unto him, put up again thy sword unto his place. This is when Peter cut off the ear of the high priest's servant, right? And this is in the garden, or after they left the garden, and now he's being taken. And so they that take the sword shall perish with the sword, he tells him. Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and shall presently he give me more than 12 legions of angels? Thousands of angels I could have here in that fast, if I just said send them. It's all I got to do. I don't need you with a sword.
Right.
I can turn this whole thing upside down right now in a heartbeat. All I got to do is ask. So he could have chosen to do none of what he did, but he decided to endure all of it. And that's amazing. And I mean, I know it's a given, and I know that we know it, but do we know it? I mean, do we really think about that in that way? So let's look at what happens when we live that way. Philippians 2, verses 12 and 13. And that's what we're talking about, is being in Christ, because you're not going to do this outside of Christ. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it's God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So Paul's really clear here. This is not natural. This isn't normal. What's natural is look out for yourself. What's natural is to build yourself up. What's natural is to, you know, take care of me. And Paul reminds us of the gospel of grace in Philippians 2:5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Try to think like Jesus is not what Paul's saying here. What he's saying is, he tells us we have the mind, this mind. It's part of the gift of the gospel. It's an act of grace that we have the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ is yours in Christ. You don't have the mind of Christ outside of Christ. So when we don't operate in Christ, we're still operating from carnal thinking. I hope I'm not being confusing here. Mm-mm. But the mind of Christ is yours in Christ. Verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. He says, let it be in you. You have an option here. You have the choice to let this be the reality.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. You have this mind, in other words, so use it. Use the mind of Christ. Mm-hmm. Philippians 2, verse 12. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, this scripture always bothered me. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And I thought, you know, I haven't always obeyed. But I'm still expected to work out my own salvation with fear and trembling? My disobedient self? So the good news is, verse 12, Paul doesn't disconnect it. He doesn't disconnect that difficulty from the empowering of grace.
Yep.
Are you with me?
Yep.
So he's not telling us up here about the obedience stuff without giving us grace to do it.
Mm-hmm.
To have the mind of Christ, he's given us the grace to do it. We just have to accept it.
Right.
We just have to receive it. Amen?
Amen.
Because he says, for it's God that works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure.
Amen.
So the sin you do, natural, the natural you, amen, and the good that you do for others, supernatural.
Mm-hmm.
You see how God sees it?
Yeah.
All right. Just remember, grace, which is the gospel, the good news, the power of God unto salvation, right? Mm-hmm. So it's always to remember, so that you don't forget that God will not expect something of you that he won't both empower you to do and then forgive you for not doing it.
Mm-hmm.
That blows my mind. He empowers us to operate in the mind of Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
And then he forgives us when we don't do it.
Right. Thank you, Lord.
That's a good God.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. That is supernatural. In a way, it's like chasing the wind. When you were a kid, you ever do that? You know, you just, like you're going to catch it or outrun it or something. But, I mean, that's kind of what this is like.
Yep.
This idea of being empowered to do things and then failing, empowered by God and then forgiven by God for not doing it after he's empowered us to do it. It's like chasing your own tail in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. So, we need to choose it.
Amen.
We need to choose to chase the wind.
Amen.
We need to choose to operate in the mind of Christ, even though we know we won't always be perfect at it. But he'll empower us. He'll give us the ability to do it. And when we fall short, he'll forgive us so that we can get back up and get back in the race. So it's not like, you know, this is a punishment thing I'm talking about here. I'm just saying we need to refocus. We need to refocus our attention on Jesus. And when we fall short, and we will, without it, we're not intending to, but we just will because we're human beings. And the good news is God will give us the power, the empowering ability to do it, and even the want to, and then he'll forgive us when we fall short.
Right.
Praise the Lord. And it's not so that we can make a big deal out of ourselves, because that's still selfish and conceited. John said, he must increase, or I must decrease, that he may increase. Now, just put that in the context of Paul saying, put on the mind of Christ. You got to shrink so that he can expand, so that he can become greater in your life, so he can be more effective in your life. In order for that to happen, we have to decrease. And that's my point. That's what I'm struggling here to get across when it comes to this anointing, that anointing, and so on and so forth, because I always draw attention to us. It's not wrong to operate in those gifts. He wants us to. But the moment it becomes about me, God's not involved anymore. I have to operate in the mind of Christ. We've all seen how these things can be abused. And people can be manipulated by it. It's never the will of God. If we're always pointing people to Jesus, God will do what God alone can do.
Amen.
And he'll use you to do it. Mm-hmm. All right? Look at Philippians chapter 2 again, verses 14 through 18 this time. If you just scroll on if you can. Do all things without murmuring and disputings, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. Yea, and if I be offered upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I joy and rejoice with you all. For the same cause also do you joy and rejoice with me.
Mm-hmm.
And what is that cause? Jesus. If we keep the focus on Jesus, we can all be celebrating and rejoicing with one another, over one another's victories, with one another's victories, and so forth. So look at this in Romans chapter 15, verses 16 through 19. Romans 15, 16 through 19. That I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. I have therefore whereof I may glory through Jesus Christ in those things which pertain to God. For I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ hath not wrought by me. So I'm not going to talk about any of the stuff I did outside of Christ. If I wasn't operating in Christ, then I'm not going to even talk about it. I may have done some stuff. I may have been patted on the back for it. I may have been told, what a great job you did. But I'm not talking about any of that. I'm not even going to refer to anything that happened outside of me being in the mind of Christ, operating in Christ, right?
Right.
So that make the jump by the word of deed. Though mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about into Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
I won't dare to speak of any of those things which Christ has not wrought by me, to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed, through mighty signs and wonders, by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem to round about unto Ithacum have fully preached the gospel of Christ. Now, what he's saying is, I'm not going to talk about anything except what Jesus did.
Yes.
And what did Jesus do? Because his focus was Jesus, presenting Jesus to the Gentiles, the grace of God to the Gentiles, mighty signs and wonders took place.
Yes.
And Paul took no credit for it. He said it was all about the message. And if the message is preached correctly, if we make the focus Jesus, the mighty signs and wonders will happen by the power of the Spirit, because the Spirit is always pointing to Jesus. So if we're pointing to Jesus, he'll validate it.
Yes, Lord.
When we're pointing to one another or to somebody else or to some thought, then the Holy Spirit's not involved in that.
Come on.
It may not be horribly bad. It may not be wrong. It may not be evil. But it's just the Holy Spirit's only interested in one thing, and that's raising up Christ, elevating Jesus before the eyes of everybody in the world.
Yes.
That's the responsibility of the church. That's what the church has to do. We have to come together in that way. Amen. But that's what Paul's saying. So not so they'll think that Paul's great.
Right.
Right? But so they will know that Christ is great.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Philippians 2, now 19, and we'll just go to through the end, 19 through 30. Through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem round about to Illyricum I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. Through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about to Illyricum I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. It's a whole lot like what I just read. Yea, so have I strived to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation. So he preached Jesus, but he went to places where nobody else was preaching it. Nobody else had heard about Jesus. But as it is written, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see, and they that have not heard shall understand, for which cause also I have been much hindered from coming to you. But now, having no more place in these parts, and having a great desire these many years to come unto you, whensoever I take my journey into Spain, I will come to you, for I trust to see you in my journey, and to be brought on my way thitherward by you, if first I be somewhat filled with your company. But now I go unto Jerusalem to minister unto the saints, for it hath pleased them of Macedonia and Achaia to make a certain contribution for the poor saints which are at Jerusalem. It hath pleased them verily, and their debtors they are, for the Gentiles have been made partakers of their spiritual things. Their duty is also to minister unto them in carnal things. When therefore I have performed this and have sealed to them this fruit, I will come by you into Spain. And I'm sure that when I come unto you, I shall come in the fullness of the blessings of the gospel of Christ. Now I beseech you, brethren, for the Lord Jesus Christ's sake and for the love of the Spirit, that you strive together with me in your prayers to God for me. Praise the Lord. Now, let's look at this in verse 21. He says, let me back up to verse 19. But I trust the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. But ye know the proof of him, that as a son with the Father, he hath served with me in the gospel. He's speaking about Timothy. Him, therefore, I hope to send presently, so soon as I shall see how it will go with me. But I trust in the Lord that I also myself shall come shortly. Yet I supposed it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, another brother, and companion in labor, a fellow soldier, but your messenger, and he that ministered to my wants. For he longed after you all and was full of heaviness because he had heard that he had been sick. For indeed he was sick nigh unto death, but God had mercy on him, and not only him, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. I sent him, therefore, the more carefully, that when ye see him again, ye may rejoice, and that I may be the less sorrowful. Receive him, therefore, in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation, because for the work of Christ he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service toward me. So, for the work of Christ, Epaphroditus and Timothy have the mind of Christ. Did you get that?
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand what Paul is saying there? The way they were able to do what they did was by having the mind of Christ. They gave up their what they wanted, what they could do for themselves, and focused on what Jesus would do in that same situation. Praise the Lord. So they did that by being in Christ or one with Christ. And he talks about the grace of God making this possible. Okay, so you're saying, okay, fine. Now, let's make this practical. Serve. And I'm wrapping up here, but I'm just saying this to lead me into what I want to talk about Sunday. And we need to serve, and we need to serve Christ. How do we serve Christ? By serving one another, right? Mm-hmm. It's the only way it can be done. That's what Jesus, you know, when Saul was knocked off his horse on the way to Damascus, Jesus said to him, why are you persecuting me? Well, he wasn't persecuting Jesus. Jesus had already been dead, buried, and resurrected. He was persecuting the church.
Right.
And Jesus said, that's me. That is my body. That's who I am. That's who you're persecuting, right? So that's what Paul is saying here. He's saying, I was persecuting the church, but now we're going to serve the church. And what are we serving? Christ. And we do it with the mind of Christ. It's the only way it can be done. Okay, so the reason for this is because we can't afford the church to become a consumer mess.
Right.
And in my opinion, in a lot of cases, that's exactly what the church has become.
Right.
User-friendly. It's all about the consumer, you know. I mean, come on, I've been to these churches. And I'm not saying this is all bad. I'm just saying they've got the cart in front of the horse here. You come in and, you know, if the parking isn't just perfect and, you know, everything isn't just exactly right, they don't want to stay. They don't want to come here. If you don't have a warm espresso for them at the door, you know, and a foot massage, they're going to go on down the road because they're not focusing on Jesus, and neither is the church. We start focusing on peripheral things and forget that this is about Christ.
Right.
And the only way you're going to get people to really adhere to that and understand that is to present that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, some people are just going to come and go anyway. But I can tell you this, we've done enough of this over the years. You can give away all the bicycles you want.
Right.
You can have all the free meals you want to give away. And people will still come and go. They'll come and get the free meal and the bicycle and ride off into the sunset.
Yep.
Because it's not about Jesus. It's about something they want,
right,
instead of what they really need.
Right.
Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't try to feed people and try to help people out. We do that all the time.
Yes.
And we should. But we do that because that's what Jesus did.
Yep.
Right.
Not because we're trying to manipulate people into coming to this particular church.
Right.
God will build the church. If we'll focus on God, God will take care of the rest of it. If we'll make the focus Jesus, he'll handle the other stuff.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So it's not what God has for us, but it's for his glory. It's not us focusing on what God, the next thing God's got for me. The focus is supposed to be on him being glorified.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? Amen? And he'll take care of me in the process.
Amen.
Generally, Christians have actually weakened the reality that the church is actually a group of people meant to represent the image of Jesus to each other and to the world. That's what God left us here for. That's the reason for us being here. And if we start representing Jesus to each other and to the world, God will build the church.
Amen.
His body will grow. And it'll impact. Because wherever Jesus is the focus, miracles will happen.
Yes.
Signs and wonders will take place. People will be healed. People will be delivered. And most importantly, people will be saved.
Yes.
Philippians 1:21. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. Now again, he's writing to a church, an existing church in that day. There's forgiveness and there's grace, but there's also learning. It's not about us. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about him.
Yes.
You know, people will come, and they come for one reason. They come to get healed, or they come for this, or they come for that. Look, come and let's give them Jesus, and they'll get their healing. Let's give them Jesus, and they'll get their deliverance. Let's give them Jesus, and they'll experience restoration. But we We can offer him all the stuff, and it won't mean a thing. It's all perishable. It won't last anyhow.
Right?
Right? I mean, it's one thing. It's the old cliche, but there's truth in it. You know, feed a man, and he'll be hungry tomorrow. You know, give a man a fish, and tomorrow he'll be hungry again, right? Teach him how to fish, and he'll be able to take care of himself. So you can give him something that Jesus has imparted, but give him Jesus, because tomorrow he'll have a need. He'll have another need, I promise you, because we deal with people all the time. You know it yourself. Yeah. And you'll tell them, God will help you here. God will help you with this. Let me pray for you. And they receive it, and they go away encouraged or feeling a little bit lighter about it. But then they come back a couple of weeks later or a month later, and they got another problem. What they need is Jesus. What they really are looking for is Jesus.
Yes.
And we're giving them placebos a lot of times instead of giving them the real thing.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Praise the Lord. To live is Christ. He's not giving us options. He's saying you got two choices here, live or die. If you live, it's Christ.
Amen.
As a Christian, that's the way it's supposed to be. If you die, praise the Lord, it's gain. Philippians 4:23, and we'll close with this. And it's a good way to close. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. And that's the way Paul closes this letter to the Philippians. And most of the letters, in fact. Why? Because he knows these are people that love God. They just don't understand it all. They're trying to figure out, and they've got people coming and going all the time, trying to tell them, you can do this, you can do that, this guy's somebody special, this one's somebody else is special, this thing is great. And Paul's saying, forget all of that. These are people that are all about themselves. Let's make this about Jesus, and he'll take care of all your needs. So in order for that to happen, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
Amen.
So be it. Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. 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 God bless you. Thank you for your patience. And we'll see you back here Sunday. Praise the Lord.